If you haven't had the chance to experiment with large language models and explore the ways they can help you provide amazing features for your applications, you are missing out. Due to the recent developments in the industry, adding AI-powered features in your apps is easier than ever. What's more exciting is that while Python is considered the de facto language of data, machine learning and artificial intelligence, JavaScript and TypeScript are also great candidates for such tasks, thanks to Dino and its Jupyter Notebook support. You'll see in the next few minutes that we can leverage Dino's batteries included approach to really push the LLM developer experience to the next level. Before jumping into the nitty-gritty, there are a few concepts we should clarify. First, while you can connect to various model hosting environments via APIs, we are going to leverage the OLAMA framework for running language models on your local machine. Then, for the language model, we will use a resized version of the DeepSeek R1 that can run locally. We'll also use a Jupyter Notebook for interactive code and text, and, of course, Dino as the kernel which offers native JavaScript and TypeScript support. First, let's install OLAMA, followed by the DeepSeek R1 8 billion parameter model. We can make sure that these are configured correctly by running the OLAMA list command. Then, in VS Code, we'll make sure the Dino extension is installed, and then we can create a new Jupyter Notebook. We will also use the LangChain library, which provides a consistent interface for interacting with large language models. We'll then create a OLAMA model based on DeepSeek. For convenience reasons, we'll also use ZUD to define the schema of the data we'll exchange with the model. In our chain, any output is parsed and validated by ZUD, so your LLM JSON must match the schema exactly. Note that LangChain, Dino and Jupyter can also document the flow visually. Finally, to test things, we can simply send a question to the chain with the appropriate format instructions. While this is a great start, you'll be surprised to find out that we can achieve much more based on this foundation. So for the next couple of minutes, we'll go further and build together an AI retrieval augmented generation agent. RAG agents are AI systems that combine retrieval-based methods with generative models to produce more accurate, contextually relevant responses to queries. RAG agents are useful for building AI chatbots with domain-specific knowledge, such as handling documentation or retrieving private data like legal documents. For this example, the plan is simple. We'll first retrieve and prepare several blog posts to be used by our agent. Then, we'll create an AI agent which has tools to query the blog post in the database, to grade if the documents are relevant to the query, and to rewrite and improve the query if required. Finally, we'll generate a response to the query based on our collection of data. We'll continue to use the DeepSeek R1, but we'll add two more models into the mix. The first will help us transform text into a form that is easier to search by AI systems. Second, we'll use a larger LLaMA model which supports tooling. This allows the large language model to call out functions that perform additional actions. Let's start by pulling the models locally. Next, we'll inform Dino how to best deal with NPM dependencies that we'll be importing dynamically by adding this line in dino.json. The first step is to gather and process the documents for our agent. We will grab a handful of posts from the Dino blog, process them, and store them in an in-memory vector store, then create a retriever which allows access to that store. To do this, we'll use Cheerio to fetch and parse the HTML content of the blog posts. Then, we'll apply a recursive text splitter to break the post into smaller chunks, making them easier for the agent to understand and work with. Finally, we'll convert these chunks into vector representations that can be indexed and searched by the retrieval system. This structure gives our AI the ability to look through relevant content quickly and return context-aware answers based on real data, not just hallucinated guesses. Now that we have our documents processed and stored, it's time to talk about how the agent actually makes decisions. You might have heard the term graph being thrown around in AI discussions. In our case, a graph just means we're structuring the way the agent thinks. Think of a flowchart for its reasoning steps. Each part of this flow, ranging from retrieving documents to grading them, rewriting queries, or generating answers, is a node in the graph. We'll connect them with logic that says what to do next based on the results of the previous step. Let's start by creating a simple state object. This state will hold the messages and data that move through the graph. We'll use that type throughout the workflow so that every function knows what it's working with. We already have our retriever that searches documents. Now we have to turn that into a tool, which is something the agent can actually use when it decides it needs more context. So we'll define the different steps the agent can take. These are all just regular functions, but each one handles a specific task. In should_retrieve, we look at the last AI message. If the AI suggested using a tool, we know it wants to retrieve documents. Otherwise, we end the chain. Grade documents feeds the question and the retrieved content to a smaller language model and asks for a simple relevance score, yes or no. This keeps things fast and cheap. Then, check relevance inspects the model's answer. If it's yes, we move on to generate a reply. If not, we try rewriting the question and start again. The agent is the brain of our implementation, and it filters out internal messages while invoking a model to decide what to do next. Rewrite improves the original query to help find more relevant results if the initial search failed. And finally, generate is the last step, where we grab the context and the question and tell the model to give a concise answer using only the information from the documents. Once we have all the pieces, we connect them in a graph. We then use state graph to define each node and then wire everything together. The process starts at the agent. If the agent decides we need more data, we hit the retrieve node. Then, we grade the documents. If the grade is positive, we go to generate. If it's not, we pass through rewrite, which loops us back to the agent to try again. The last step is compiling this graph into a runnable workflow. Note that if you're in a Jupyter notebook, Dino can even show a visual representation of everything. Once all the code is in place, it's time to actually use the agent. We can test it with a pretty simple question. We'll wrap it into a human message, feed it to the workflow, and stream the results. Then, the agent goes through the entire flow we just built. It decides what to do, maybe fetches documents, maybe rewrites the query, and finally gives us a clean, informed answer. Finally, we print the response in Markdown, and we're done. These demos should give you an idea about the seamless process of working with LLM these days. Let us know in the comments if you are interested in exploring this topic further, and until next time, thank you for watching.